Assalamu alaikum rahmatullah. If you like what you're about to watch, please share and subscribe and click the like button.
Alhamdulillah. نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فهو من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في الكتاب الكريم بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون وقال عز وجل يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. We begin in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by praising Him and glorifying Him. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send His peace and blessings upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for refuge from the evil that is within ourselves. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower this gathering with His mercy, with His peace, with His guidance. And I bear witness before all of you that there is none worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I bear witness before all of you that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his last and final messenger. Allah says in the Quran, O people of Iman, O believers, be conscious, be aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way He deserves. And don't leave this world, don't die except in a state of Islam. And He says in the Quran, O people of Iman, O believers, be conscious of Allah, be aware of Allah, and speak good words. He says, He will take care of your affairs for you. يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. You take care of your words and you have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, and He will take care of all of your affairs for you, all your problems, anything you're going through, He will manage it for you. وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. And on top of that, He will forgive you your sins. وَمَنْ يُتَعِ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ فَازَ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا. And whoever obeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and obeys His messenger, indeed they have attained the greatest success. Now, alhamdulillah, we come here week after week to pray the Jummah prayer. And for some, it's become a cultural thing. For some, it's become a routine, a habit. But sometimes we have to reflect on the meaning of this gathering. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Surah Jummah, that when the call for prayer comes on the day of Jummah, Allah says, leave whatever you're doing. Doesn't matter if you're at work, if you're with family, whatever it is, close your shop and come to the prayer. And it says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is much better for you if you only knew. If you only knew. And this phrase, our scholar said, if you only knew, speaks volumes. Because if you reflect on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, this is better for you if you only knew, it means the blessings that's in this gathering, the barakah that's in this gathering, the guidance, the light that's in this gathering, it is unmatched by anything else that you can go and find in this world. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he described to us one hadith. And whenever a group of people gather together to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there is a group of angels, they have been charged with a special task to find gatherings like this. So they're looking around the earth, they're roaming everywhere, and when they find one, he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it looks to them like a shining star. Now we can have a picture from a satellite, you know, you look down to a city that's well lit in the middle of the night, it's like that. The whole world is covered in darkness, except for places where Allah is being mentioned. And when these angels see this gathering, they start to call one another. They say, hey, we found one, let's go. And they surround this gathering. Now, the Prophet ﷺ is hadith. We can't see these angels, but they're here. The Prophet ﷺ said this happens. They surround the gathering. And they start to write down the names of every single person that's here. So, Brother Muhammad, he's here. Brother Abdullah, he's here. Brother Ibrahim, he's here. They start writing the names one by one by one. And then more angels come. And they'll pass on the records. And as these angels come, they start to stack and stack and stack. And they go into the higher realms, the higher skies, until they reach the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's like a pillar of light, angels from this gathering. And one of them, representing this entire gathering of angels and humans, they approach the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they start giving their report. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, where are you coming from? Allah, He knows where the angels have been, where they're coming from. But Allah asks to show emphasis, and the angel is so excited, says, Ya Allah, we're coming from this place called Ashburn, Virginia. There's a gathering under the banner of Adam Center. People have come and they're glorifying you. They're calling your names holy and they're declaring your oneness. Ya Allah, and the angel's excited, giving reports. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you know, as he's receiving the names, he says, what do these people want? Ya Allah, they want to go to Jannah. They want to go to Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, have these people seen Jannah? Have you seen Jannah? The angels say, no, Ya Allah, they have not seen Jannah. You know, they're worshipping you, they have not seen you. They want Jannah, they have not seen Jannah. Allah will say, what if they saw Jannah? The angels say, Ya Allah, if they saw Jannah, one of the scholars wrote, what if you went to sleep? And in your sleep, what if you had a dream? And in your dream, what if you were in paradise, in Jannah? And in your dream of Jannah, what if you picked a flower, a beautiful flower, and you woke up and you still had the flower? How would it be? How would you live the rest of your life? You have a flower from Jannah. How would you live the rest of your life? So Allah says, what if they saw Jannah? What if they saw it with their own eyes? The angel will say, Ya Allah, if they saw Jannah, they would always, always be in a state of worship. They would not do anything except be in your remembrance. They would spend their entire living time doing something good so they can achieve higher and higher levels of Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, what else do they want? Ya Allah, they're afraid of hellfire. They don't want to go to hellfire. Ya Allah, they're saying, Allahumma ajirna minan nar. Oh Allah, save us from the torment of the fire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask, have these people seen hellfire? Angel will say, no, Ya Allah, they have not. What if they saw hellfire? What if you saw hellfire? How would you live the rest of your life? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he saw it with his eyes. In Isra al-Mi'raj, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him an entire tour of Jannah and hellfire and everything. And so, you know, he knew the reality. And that's why his normal state, they said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his normal state was sadness. He was sad. His normal state was sad because he knew what's coming. He knew the Day of Judgment, what it will be like. He knew hellfire, what it will be like. And these people disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and fighting against the truth and doing all of these things, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not angry with them. He was concerned about them. So what if you saw hellfire? The angel would say, Ya Allah, if they saw hellfire, they would never do anything wrong. They would not even wish it upon their worst enemies. Ya Allah, they would be always trying to avoid anything that brings them closer to it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to this angel, this is happening right now. He says, I make you a witness that I forgive all of them. I forgive all of them. The angel cannot believe it. They say, Ya Allah, all of them? Allah will say, you are a witness, all of them are forgiven. The angel will say, Ya Allah, but there is this one person there. He didn't really want to come to Jummah. It's kind of like his friends dragged him to the masjid. He's not part of this gathering. He was forced to be there. Or this kid, he didn't want to come. His father grabbed him by the ear and said, get in the car, we're going to Jummah. Right? So they were forced to come. Allah will say, you are witness, I forgive even them. The mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When it comes down, it is a floodgate. It's a vast thing. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one time he was in the masjid giving a talk, and the Sahaba sitting and listening, they described, when we were sitting while the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to talk, you could have birds on our heads and they would not move from how calm and relaxed we were. Right? But what happened? Something disturbed this relaxation of the Sahaba while they're listening to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One of the Bedouins entered the masjid, an old man, doesn't know about the etiquettes of masjid. Doesn't know how you're supposed to behave in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Doesn't know how you're supposed to behave in the presence of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was sitting, he was listening, and suddenly he had to use the bathroom. So he got up and he walked to one of the walls in the back of the masjid and he started using the bathroom in the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Imagine the reaction of the Sahaba. Like all of them jumped up on their feet, and Omar, you can just imagine Omar with his big mustache and bald head, and he's as tall as, you know, two horses stacked on each other. Omar jumped up, all these Sahaba jumped up, and they start charging towards this person. Hey, you, stop! And this person was so afraid. The commentator said, had he not been already using the bathroom, he would have wet his pants. Because the Sahaba, they're fierce companions of the Prophet, they're warriors. And they're charging at this person. And so what happened? The Prophet ﷺ was the one who spoke up and said, stop. Let him finish. And so the man, he finished and he's looking around with fear. The Prophet ﷺ said, bring a bucket of water and clean it up. So they cleaned it up. And the man, you know, seeing that his savior was Muhammad ﷺ, who saved him from getting beat up by this mob of men, he started making dua. He said, Ya Allah, have mercy on me and have mercy on Muhammad and nobody else, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, have mercy on me and have mercy on Muhammad and no one else. And the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he smiled to this person and he said, you have tried to limit something that is very vast. That is very vast. Some people, they think they can dish out the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They walk through their life. So-and-so does something good to them, they say, oh, this person definitely goes to Jannah. So-and-so harms them, they say, this person, how are they going to answer Allah? They're definitely going to hellfire. And they dish out the mercy of Allah and they cut people off from the mercy of Allah based on their desires. But don't try to limit the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah's mercy is vast and He gives it to whoever He wants. But as for you and me, we have to look to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know, Sahaba were always around the Prophet ﷺ. All their concern, all their ambition, all their goal was, how can I be more like Muhammad ﷺ? This is all they wanted. One Sahabi was sitting in the masjid. They prayed with the Prophet ﷺ, duhur prayer. Rasulullah ﷺ got up and left. Everybody dispersed to their jobs. And when the Prophet ﷺ came back for asr prayer, he saw this man sitting there. And he looked very sad. And Rasulullah said, what's going on? You okay? Everything's okay? He said, Ya Rasulullah, I missed you. He said, we just prayed duhur together. How can you miss me already? He said, no, Ya Rasulullah, you don't understand. I've been thinking, you see? I've been thinking. And thinking is a powerful thing. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to think. And he said, I've been thinking, Ya Rasulullah, you are the messenger of Allah. And you'll, you know, no doubt when you leave this world, you'll have the highest places in Jannah. Jannatul Wasilat wal Fadila, the highest places Allah has prepared for you. He said, and I'm just an average person, and I don't have good deeds like Abu Bakr. I don't have courage like Umar. I don't have knowledge like Ali. I cannot do much like these other great Sahaba. So I'm worried I might not even make it to Jannah. And he said, you know, and you will be so high up, and I might not even see you even if I make it to Jannah. So I was thinking about that, and I started to realize how much I missed you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he smiled at this person with his beaming smile, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he put his hands on his shoulder and he said, "You'll be with the one you love. You'll be with the one you love, right? The one you love, you want to imitate. The one you love, you want to be like. Why do people dress up like Lady Gaga? They love her. They want to be like her. Why do people dress up like Justin Bieber? You know, they love him. They want to be like him. But when you want to be like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam." When you love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you want to follow his sunnah. He said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you will be with the one you love. Sahaba said there was not a moment in Medina when we were happier than that moment when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said this. You'll be with the one you love. You know, and loving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you can love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and still be struggling with yourself. You know, one Sahabi, he would get drunk after the prohibition of alcohol came down. And he was on the streets of Medina, drunk, Sahabi. And the Sahaba, they grabbed him and they said, you know, take him to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he got lashed publicly. Again, the next day, he was in that same state. And again, you know, he was in the same state. And when they were lashing him, Umar radiallahu anhu cursed him. He said, this fool person, he never learns. I mean, you know, he starts saying some things about him. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, don't say that, O Umar. Verily, I swear, this man, he loves Allah and his messenger. He's struggling. He's fighting his sins. He's trying to get over addiction. But he loves Allah and his messenger, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said that about him. You know, what would I give to be in the position of that person who's being whipped and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, he loves Allah and his messenger. Subhanallah. So, we have to recognize as the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we're now living in a time and a place where we are far removed from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He lived 1400 something years ago, and so there's all that time between us. And You know, some people are going to Hajj, inshallah, and some people live in the blessed land. They're still walking where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam walked. Their heads still touch the ground where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made sujood. We are now on the other side of the world. But there is still a link that connects us to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You're here in Jummah, remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hearing the adhan, Ashhadu anna Muhammadun Rasulullah. This echo that lasted from the voice of Bilal radiallahu anhu, when he got up and he declared, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu anna Muhammadun Rasulullah. It echoed throughout the world, throughout the time, to this day, every moment, someplace in the world, somebody saying, Ashhadu anna Muhammadun Rasulullah. And it will go on until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills. And we are the people who are responding to this call. This is a great gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so we still have that link because we want to be like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I had a friend, he lives in Maryland. He really wanted to be like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He studied the books of Shima'il, the books on description of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He started to grow his beard out, he started to wear a certain type of clothing. And what happened, he was very adamant, and one day, of course, you know, if somebody would say something to him, he would say, this is sunnah, don't you know? He would get mad. Defending the sunnah, it's not a bad thing. But one day he had a dream. He narrated his dream to me. He said in his dream, he came to the masjid in Baltimore. And he said, there is a man giving khutbah, and he heard his voice, and he recognized right away, this is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he said he was so excited, he jumped into the masjid and he saw the masjid was full. And he said, because he wanted to see the Prophet so badly, he didn't care if masjid is full or not, he started jumping over the people, trying to get to the first row. And this is not proper way to behave in the masjid. The Prophet said, wherever you find a place, sit there. But he said he wanted to see the Prophet so badly, he started jumping over the people, trying to get to the front row. And finally he arrived to the front row. And he was just about to look up and see the beautiful face of our beloved sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And right before he could do that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam walked away from him. Walked around the gathering, went to the back, and he said, don't look at me. Listen to what I'm saying. Don't look at me. Listen to what I'm saying. And so, you know, there's a profound message in this dream. I was for him, and I felt it's for the ummah, because sometimes you want to follow the sunnah in such a way that the image of the Prophet ﷺ becomes what we strive for. But we have to strive for more than his image. We have to be like Muhammad ﷺ. We have to shape our hearts like the heart of the Prophet ﷺ. We have to shape our behavior, the way we carry ourselves, the way we deal with one another, the way Rasulullah ﷺ dealt with the people. And the best way you can do that, practice it in your life, is look at how your family situation is. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Khayrukum khayrukum li ahli, wa ana khayrukum li ahli." He said, "Best of you are those who are best to their families, and I am the best to my family." Sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Right, and every time, of course, when we have somebody that we share our lives with, we spend a lot of time with, the chances of us hurting that person is much greater. The chances of us doing oppression is much greater. You know me a little bit. You see me in the masjid here and there. The chance of me oppressing you is very small. Maybe I'll extend the khutbah longer than normal and you might lose your job. That might happen. But normally, because we don't expose each other, we don't have a lot of shared time, the chances of us hurting one another, oppressing one another is very small. But the one you live with, your wife, your husband, your father, your mother, your children, you know, the chances of us hurting them is much, much greater. And so Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was teaching us that you have to be best with your family in order to be like him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's one of the measuring sticks. If you want to see how much like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam you are, look at the condition of your house. Look at the condition of your family. And of course, we have conflicts. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had conflicts. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a human being. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ يُوحَى إِلَيْهِ. Tell them, Ya Rasulullah, I am a human being like you, but I have received wahi from Allah. And so he had human emotions, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He would get angry. There were things that bothered him, there were things that annoyed him. But every time he would get angry, his anger was measured anger. It was for the right cause and at the right person. You know, and we have some people, they have something happen at work, and then they come home and the kids go to sleep crying. Why? Because the father, you know, he's angry, he's upset, he said this and that. What did the kids have to do with what happened at work? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had a lot of responsibility on his shoulders. Some people might say, yeah, but you know, in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he didn't have like due dates, he didn't have this, he didn't have boss, he didn't have this. You know, he didn't have all these things. We're stressed out. That's why we, you know, sometimes we lash out. You think you have more responsibility than Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? You know, he had military responsibilities, he had legislative responsibility, he was establishing an entire new society, he was dealing with the Jahiliyyah of the Arabs, he was fighting with the Quraysh, he had all these things on his plate, and still he would come home and he would smile to his family, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when there was difficulties, when there was disagreements, one time our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, she had a disagreement with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they couldn't come to a conclusion. And you know, sometimes when you get into an argument, it no longer becomes about the argument. Sometimes it becomes about the ego. I want to prove to them I am right. And in relationships, there's always this power dynamic. Everybody wants to dominate the other. The Prophet ﷺ was not like that. That's not his sunnah. And we are to be like the people of the Prophet ﷺ. So, you know, he said, okay, Aisha, I see that we cannot come to agreement about this. Let's find somebody to mediate between us. A third person to come, and they will look and they will see from unbiased perspective to see what's going on. And Aisha radiallahu anha, she agreed. She said, okay, that sounds like a good idea. So the Prophet said, what do you think? Is Omar a good person? She said, no. Omar, he's too biased. He likes you too much. He said, okay, what about Abu Bakr, your father? She said, yeah, I'll accept Abu Bakr as my father, as a mediator. She didn't say he's too biased, he likes me because I'm, no. She said, I accept him. Okay, so they called Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu came and he sat down. Prophet sitting there, Aisha radiallahu anhu sitting there. He said, what's going on? Everything okay? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you want to go first or should I go first? She said, you go first. And make sure you tell the truth and don't leave anything out. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a sadiq al-amin. You cannot say, make sure you tell the truth to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it's, you know, it's a breach of adab. And the Prophet ﷺ is silent, he didn't say anything, but Abu Bakr, oh man, his face turned red. And suddenly, like, anger is seeping through his veins, and suddenly he stood up and he said, Aisha, how dare you speak to the Prophet? And he raised his hand, and Aisha radiallahu anha, she ran behind the Prophet ﷺ, and she huddled up behind his shoulder, and she said, Ya Rasulullah, save me! And she's finding refuge behind the broad shoulders of our beloved Prophet ﷺ. And the Prophet ﷺ said, oh Abu Bakr, we didn't call you for this. I could do that too. I can raise my voice also. He said, you know, leave us, we'll work it out. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu walked away. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Muhammad ibn Abdullah, the beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his sunnah was to diffuse problems. He did not escalate problems. And the best thing that one of his sunnah, one of his teachings, is when you come into a situation, don't throw blame on others. Sometimes we complain. You know, we complain about everything. We complain about this person and that person, and she's not living up to the expectations, and he's not living up to the expectations, and my kids are like this, and my, you know, we complain about other people. But, you know, our scholar said complaining is from the ego, because the ego wants to be right. And when you complain about others, you're saying they are wrong and I'm right. Some people complain about traffic lights and the weather. You know, it's still raining. It's as if the rain is wrong and I'm right. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Hasibu anfusakum." You take yourself to account. Look at yourself and say, am I following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Or am I the one instigating this? Am I following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Or am I the one holding grudges? Am I the one following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Or am I the one stirring the conflict and making things worse? And when you start to look to yourself and you admit that maybe I am doing something wrong, that's the first step to solving any kind of conflict. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those who follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. قُلِ قَوْلِ هَذَا أَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ وَلَكُمْ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى أما بعد. And so, final words of reminder, and we're going to finish with this. We are the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You are the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there are people who are part of the Ummah, but they might lose that privilege. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when you are resurrected on the Day of Judgment, and you come out of your graves, he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, come and find me. Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, where will we find you? He said, I will be by the Hawd of Kawthar. Allah has given me a pool there. Come and find me and I'll give you drink, because there is no drink on that day except the drink that Allah provides. And so the Prophet ﷺ said, you know, there will be angels guarding the place. Not anybody can walk in. And they'll only let my ummah through. Sahaba said, how will they know that we are from your ummah, Ya Rasulullah? He said, you will have light on your faces, on your hands, on your feet. It will be the glow of the traces of your wudu. And he said, but there will be some people, even if they have wudu, even if they have the light of the wudu, they will come and the angels will not let them through. And they will call out to me, Ya Rasulullah, I'm from your ummah, please, let me enter. And he said, I will tell the angels, let him through. The angels will say, Ya Rasulullah, you don't know what they did after you left. We have orders not to let this one through and that one through. They have been cut off from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because they cut themselves off from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We don't want to be amongst those people. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shape our hearts the way He shaped the heart of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fix our families, to fix the ill will between us. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to unite our hearts. And we ask Allah, Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, make us amongst those who behave and speak and do as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, we ask you to protect us from any kind of thing that will define us as a person without adab, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, we ask you to make us amongst those who are resurrected on the Day of Judgment, who receive drink from the hands of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and who sit in the company of the righteous, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, we ask you, and do not let us die except in a state of Islam, and make our last words, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, wa akhiru da'wana an alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in, aqimu salam. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Jazakallah khair for watching. If you like what you saw, please subscribe and share. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you also. Jazakallah khair.